Blackstone Audio presents Night of the Juggler by William P. McGivern. Chapter 1. His name was Gus. He had another name, of course, a last name, but sometimes he forgot it. When this occurred, when he was swept by a dreadful and chilling loss of identity, the experience made him as tense as a threatened animal, and deepened a redness in his mind that caused him to shake with fury. When they teased him about this in the fruit and vegetable store he helped keep clean, when the Puerto Rican clerks would laugh at him and say, "Hey, Gus, you Gus who? Gus who?" he would avoid their eyes and try to control the trembling in his hands, while wondering in his dim, lacerated mind at their cruelty. When this happened, when the insolent clerks with their soft eyes and glossy hair and slurred liquid English grinned at him and teased him, Señor Perez, who owned this decrepit vegetable shop in the South Bronx, would give them angry, warning headshakes, and the clerks would stop smiling, and some might even shrug in a gesture that suggested an indifferent contrition, and then they would all return to their work, ripping brown outer leaves from heads of lettuce, watering mounds of green onions and young cabbages, waiting on the Puerto Ricans and occasional blacks who bought their meager orders of fruits and vegetables at Señor Perez's shop in this pocket of decay in New York City. At these times, Gus would go into the back room of the shop, and when no one was looking at him, he would hurry into the alley that ran through an area near 135th Street and St. Anne's Avenue. He was more at home in alleys and in darkness than he was in the shop or in daylight on crowded sidewalks. A tall, huge man, Gus went along the alley with the stalking strides of an animal, at home with the stink of garbage, the slithering sound of rats, and groups of Puerto Ricans in leather jackets bunched ominously at street corners. None of this fetid and potentially dangerous ambience menaced him. It was not so much that he was confident in this environment, it was rather that he was simply unaware of it. In the vestibule of the tenement where he lived with Mrs. Schultz in a small rented room, Gus would stare with an annealing sense of impending relief at the dirty oblong cards beneath the mailboxes. When he found Mrs. Schultz's name, he would drop his eyes an inch, and there, penciled in below it, was his own name, Gus Soltik. He never received any mail. There was no one to write to him, but it gave him a sense of security to know that his name was written there under the mailbox. He couldn't read his name, in a conventional sense, but he had memorized those particular letter shapes and knew the smudged pencil marks meant Gus Soltik. While he could not make change and had only vague notions of the value of money, he was familiar with the concept of numbers and could easily make his way to the numerically designated streets in the various boroughs of New York City. Gus Soltik's thought processes were unconventional, to put it as simply as possible. He did not think in consecutive patterns. It was as difficult for him to string ideas together as it would have been for a normal person to enumerate and define the physical objects of his environment without an alphabet. Thus, to understand concepts and emotions and things, Gus Soltik required a specific word which appeared in his mind as clearly as if it were written in chalk on slate. Thus, the word cage was his reference for all animals. He had no name, however, for his physical needs. He had no way to get inside himself. He was conscious of his existence as an object, but there was no way he could assess or conceive of Gus Soltik in subjective terms. He did not know that his odor was rank. He wasn't aware that people on the sidewalks frequently turned to stare after him. He did not understand why it made him feel so desolate and desperate when he forgot his name. It was one of the many things he didn't understand, although it worried him the most. He didn't know that his physical strength was as great as the combined strength of several average men. He did not know, for another thing, that the small yellow leather hat he wore above his bulging forehead made him look ridiculous, as if he were a mongoloid child dressed by someone with a malicious sense of humor. But Gus Soltik knew some things with the instincts of an animal. His eyesight was acute, and his sense of hearing was exceptional. He was always the first to be aware of approaching subway trains, for example, and in the old tenement where he lived, he could track Mrs. Schultz all through the house by her footsteps, even though she wore soft felt slippers indoors. His sense of direction was impeccable. He could drift through any of the boroughs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.